So first of all, let me thank you all of you for still being here at the end of this conference, and also thank the organizer for putting out such a great conference. It is my first time here, and I really enjoy it, and also for giving me the opportunity to share some of the results that I'm really excited to present you this morning. So basically, I'm going to show you some results that has to do with the scanning SQUID microscopy that we developed at the Weizmann Institute. Is this working? Yeah. Okay. That we've been developing at the Weizmann Institute in Eli Zaldov's group over the last almost 10 years, also in collaboration with Martin Huber at University of Colorado Denver, and also point out the contribution of Amit Finkler, which is in the audience, one of the father of the technique, who's now in Stuttgart. So I'm going to tell you basically two different stories, and I'm not going to talk too much about the technique, but really how you can get physics and probe new physics out of it. So I'm basically trying to convince you that the technique is now mature enough that we can actually probe a condensed matter system with it. So the first story has to do with vortex dynamic, more specifically the interaction between a vortex and a pinning site. And that was done in collaboration with Alex Gurevich at Old Dominion University. And the second story has to do with the complex oxide heterostructure. And for that, we collaborated with Ariando's group at the National University of Singapore. So just I'll go quickly flash this one slide only on the technique. So in case you missed Eli Zaldov's talk yesterday, basically we developed a nano squid that you can see the SEM picture here. It consists of two lead leads that are separated here by a non-percolating gap. And these two superconducting leads connect the SQUID loop here. And the main advantage of this technique is that the SQUID loop can be made very small. Here it's 150 nanometer, but we can actually go down to about 40 nanometers. But more importantly, the advantage is that you can get this loop very close to the sample that you're trying to measure. And as you all know, this is a crucial aspect. So the idea is to mount one of these pipettes in a scanning probe microscope and to do scanning SQUID microscopy. So I'll go over the feature again. It has a suitable geometry to do scanning SQUID because it's small, because you can get it close to the sample. As a result, it is very sensitive. We get 0.38, or about a third of a Bohr magneton sensitivity, or if you prefer, flux noise of about 50 nanofine knots, which is really good for SQUIDs. And moreover, we get a very good spatial resolution of, let's say, tens of nanometer, which is much better than usually micron size that is achieved for SQUID. And finally, we can work to unprecedented high field of about 2 tesla. So I'll skip to the first part of the talk, which I'm going to talk about vortices. So this is the sample that we've been looking at. It's a lead film that you can see here in an SEM picture that was patterned into 6 constricted bridges that you can see in light gray, and underlying dark gray is just the silicon substrate. And if you look at one of these constrictions with our microscope in an external applied film, so lead is a superconductor, at 4 Kelvin, this is what you see. You see a bunch of vortices. Now, vortices are interesting to study for all sorts of reasons. You can think about studying dissipation of when the normal core moves into the superfluid. You can think about more exotic physics in terms of manipulating topological state of matter and doing braiding operation and quantum computing and so on. So there's a lot of interest of these objects. But there's still a lot of thing about their dynamic that is not understood. And if you look at this picture, for example, you would see that this is not a regular lattice. It's not the Abrikosov lattice. And the reason for that is that there is defects in the material that cause pinning. So as you know, the vortex core is normal. You need to suppress the order parameter into the core. And there are places where there are defects where it costs less energy to suppress that order parameter. And this is where the vortex will prefer to sit. So pinning plays a major role in many, many materials, but Until now, no one really measured the energy of the interaction energy between a pinning site or a pin and a vortex. And the reason for that is that each pin usually actuates over a radius of about xi, the coherence length. And for even for lead, where xi is rather big, it's about 50 nanometers. So if one wants to really map out the potential landscape of that interaction, it needs to have a sub-50 nanometer resolution. Okay, so I will show you how we can achieve this. And basically, we're going to probe our vortices here by using current. So if I input a current in this constriction, the vortex, each of the vortices there will feel transversal Lorentz force. Okay, so I input a current in the vertical, and the vortex feel horizontal force. Okay. So now I'll switch to another sample, but it's okay. So the vortex changed color here. Now they were bright. Now here they're dark. But okay, except from that, the image looks exactly the same. It's a constricted bridges, a constricted bridge just with dark vortices. But what I'm not telling you is actually I'm driving these vortices with an AC current. Okay, so they're actually each of these vortices here is wiggling inside its potential well. They're shaking at a frequency of 3.5 kilohertz in this case. So this current here generates a force like this. So this is the DC time average. You just see static vortices. But actually, if you look at the AC signal, what you see is a bunch of dark and white spots for each of the vortices. Now, why is that? If you think about the vortex shaking into its potential well, and you think about the tip sitting here, it will actually record a modulation of the magnetic field. If the tip sits on the other side of the vortex where the slope is negative, it will feel the same modulation but completely out of phase. And by interpolating between these two situations, you see that you will see a dark or bright and dark spot for each of the vortex. Okay? Now, why do we go through all this trouble? Is basically because this amplitude is directly related to the amplitude of this motion. And basically what we're doing here is we're playing a trick where we're converting a spatial information into a magnetic information that this is the quantity that we're most sensitive to. So now actually you can go back to this image and say, okay, by how much this guy is oscillating, and you can calculate that, and this guy is shaking by about 15 angstrom. Okay, because it has a very bright spot and it oscillates by 15 angstrom. But the squid here is a quarter micron, right? But we can still resolve very fine motion. And if you calculate the amplitude of this guy, it's about one angstrom. And actually, you can push this further and reduce the applied AC force. And you see here the linear relation between the AC force and the amplitude. And you can go down to 10 picometers. So when I was telling you that you need a good spatial resolution to map the potential landscape of the interaction between a vortex and its pin, then if you look at Xi, it's all the way up there. So we have plenty of resolution to conduct this study. So basically the idea is that if you go back to this picture is that each of these amplitude will tell you the information about the restoring force at that specific point. So here, for example, the vortex, which corresponds to this central one, has a very shallow potential, whereas these one here seems to have a more abrupt potential, which causes this vortex to oscillate with less amplitude. So we wanted to conduct a more systematic study. So in this picture here, it's very busy, very crowded. There's also vortex-vortex interaction that you need to take into account. So actually, we went to another sample, also with a straight, with no constriction, just a straight bridge. And we managed to field cool a single vortex in this whole sample, which is several micron square. And again, we apply an AC current, which generate this dark and white spot. But that, as I said, gives you the restoring force at that specific point, but you also want to address the restoring force at other points. So as you shake the vortex, you also apply a DC force and move the vortex around. So, and then to further simplify the picture, we also took our film to be a thin film in between Xi and Lambda, which makes, which simplifies the analysis, and we can actually consider our vortex as a point particle rather than an elastic string. And all these experiments were done at 4.2 Kelvin. So this is how the real data looks like. So what I'm in this particular frame, so I'm going to show you a movie, but in the first frame, as the meter here shows, I'm actually pushing the vortex with 4.4 piconewton towards the left side of the screen. So I'm actually pushing the vortex like this. I will release it, and then pull on it, and then push it back. Okay, so this here tells you how abrupt, how steep is the force. And on top of it, I display the integrated trajectory. So now I'm running the movie. So you see the vortex is moving actually in the same direction as the applied force, which is horizontal, as always. So it's moving more or less along the same direction. And soon it will jump to another well, and then jump here. And now pay attention, they're all on the same scale here. This is very stiff well. It barely oscillates. You can barely see the spots, but that will change. And pay attention to the angle here. So I'm pushing in this direction, horizontal. The vortex is actually moving upwards, steer a bit, jumps, and jumps again. Okay. So if you're into this, you know, braiding operation and so on, then you will realize that it seems like naturally we found and it appears to be quite common closed loop of clusters of well that form closed loop. We don't really understand why, but that turned out to be the case. It could be also engineered, but anyway. So so that might be useful to do some other stuff. Also pay attention to these jumps in between the wells. So they're quite long. They're like, let's say, tens of coherence length. So as soon as the vortex jump out of the well, it goes, at least to us, instantaneously to another well, and then you can move it around. So basically what we're doing is the following. This is the potential landscape. This one I made out of three different wells that are made each of them of a Lorentzian, centered at three different points. And if you take the derivative, you have the restoring force. And basically, this is what we measure. We measure the slope here, and the one over the slope. So basically, we measure one over the spring constant. So this is what we measure here. And this is quite a generic potential for any theory that represents pinning forces. That you would see that the potential is harmonic around the equilibrium position, and it should be the restoring force should rounds before the vortex jumps from one potential well to the other well with matching restoring force. Okay, so our constant spring constant around the equilibrium, harmonic potential, and then it should go sub. It should go near the inflection point. It should diverge like this. Okay, so this is, as I said, the picture. And also, if you think about it in Y, if I push in X, there shouldn't be any motion in Y, right? In principle. So if we look at potential well number two, which was actually this one right here, okay. But I picked this one, but I could pick almost any other one. And this is what we observe. So actually, it's a completely different type of response where you have a big, big softening here, or a very loose vortex, if you want, in the central part of the well, whereas you don't have that much softening on the edges. Also, if you look at the Y component, it's also a significant part of the X component. Basically, it means that if I push in X, the vortex displaces in Y. Another way to see it is in the XY trajectory. You expect a straight line. What we observe is an S shape. Okay, so the vortex really does like some sort of slalom, and even more interestingly is that here the inflection point of the trajectory correspond with this very soft point. So it seems that we have a discrepancy with let's say the basic theory of pinning. We'll go back to this a bit later. Just to show you what else we can do with this data, we can also plot the position versus the force. And finally, you can plot the potential energy versus the force. So now we have a relative energy scale of this well. And actually, we were very surprised to find out that it's about 1.2 eV. So this well is extremely deep. It's about 1/10 of the whole condensation energy of the vortex. So just go back to the observation. So we have find rich internal structure within the well, large softening in the center. We have this absence of softening, which we call the broken spring effect. So it's like if you're pulling on a spring and it breaks suddenly. We have a large anisotropy and a non-trivial trajectory and a correlation between this inflection point here and this softening point. So how can we explain this? So we actually took a very simple model. Well, we take only four pins, classical pins, as predicted by theory, and we put two of them relatively close together at about a psi distance, and we put these two other one at a distance a bit larger than psi. And if I take a line cut on this potential landscape, this is just x and y, it seems like I haven't done anything. This looks like a Lorentzian potential, but actually if you take the derivative, you see you miss maybe a little kink here, but nothing too dramatic. This is a clear rounding of the restoring force. There seems that we haven't done anything, but actually what we're measuring is not exactly that. What we're measuring is the trajectory, the potential line along this trajectory, which is far more intricate than that. And actually, if I plot the energy here, so these are unstable point, but this is the well number two that we tried to mimic. It actually looks like these wells, these satellite wells, actually break the spring. So how come the vortex feels this sort of interaction, which are pins always about psi apart, is just because it averages over that core, and actually we find out that by just putting a random distribution, each of the pins' action will auto-assemble itself into stronger pins that are each of them about psi apart from each other, and the fact that some of them are a bit closer than psi and some of them a bit further away than psi give this rich dynamic that we were observing. So, and then if you look at how we can, if you go back to the data, then you see that the simulated trajectory with this system is about the same. We didn't intend to fit it exactly, but all the features are there. Same with the displacement. It also fits quite well. Our model fits quite well the experiment. So now let me switch gear to another type of system, which is a complex oxide heterostructure. So over the last year, generated a lot of interest, and perhaps the most popular system is lanthanum aluminate grown on strontium titanate. As you can see here, they managed to do this atomically sharp heterostructure and between STO and LAO. And basically the interest rises from the fact that you bring together two, in principle, boring band insulator and in contact with each other, there is actually 2D electron gas that emerges at the interface. And even more than that, it was also shown that you can have even superconductivity and that you can tune the TC of the superconductivity with a back gate. So why is all these phenomena happen is still subject to some debate. One of the explanation is the so-called polar catastrophe. And it's just by doing the electrostatic of this system, you realize that on this particular direction, the STO carry no net charge per layer, whereas the LAO carry a plus and minus alternating charge for each of the layers. Now, basically, that's a stack of capacitors. And as you know, between two capacitors, the electric field is constant. And between and outside, the electric field is zero. And then you get to the next capacitor, you get electric field again, and zero, and so on. And then if you do the integral of this field, it will give you a diverging voltage that is generated between the interface and the surface. Now, of course, this is not what happens. And to solve this so-called polar catastrophe, it is believed that you have a transfer of charge from the surface to the interface of half an electron per unit cell. And now, what that does is that it shifts this square wave function, if you want to be around zero. And then, if you integrate this, you actually have a bounded voltage. Okay. So that was all done on LAO STO, but like I said, LAO is a relatively standard band insulator. And what we were thinking of is what if we take a material that is a bit more complex that actually has magnetic order. So one of these material is LMO, lanthanum manganite, which is an antiferromagnet and a MOT insulator. And basically, if you add electron, if you dope this material by, let's say, this mechanism here, it switches from being an antiferromagnet to a ferromagnet. Okay, so we wanted to see how this will behave in this system. So basically, we did the magnetic measurements. So by applying an in-plane field here, and you see that for a 5-unit cell of LMO, there's almost no magnetic signal. But if you add a single layer of LMO, you find a clear signal, which is similar to an in-plane ferromagnet. So you have an hysteresis and so on. But what is funny is that in this system, which is a MOT insulator antiferromagnet, when you actually dope the system, you expect ferromagnetism to come together with conductivity. But the film here remained insulating, so it was a bit puzzling, and we thought maybe there's something on the local scale happening. So that was actually a good mission for the SQUID, and wanted to map out what is the magnetic structure of this seemingly ferromagnet from a global measurement. So what I'm showing you here is the saturation magnetization. It's basically this value here as a function of the layer, of the number of LMO layer. And you see here, this is 4, 5, and then it jumps. And let's see what the SQUID on tip says. So this is for the 4-unit cell. You see some magnetic structure, but it's very faint. At 5-unit cell, it grows a bit, but nothing too dramatic. And this is consistent with antiferromagnetic domains still emitting some stray fields, but in general, from the global measurement, they should give very weak signal. And if you add the one layer, you see that this amplitude here rises by more than an order of magnitude. Now, what's interesting here is that what you observe in the millimeter, in a 5x5 millimeter sample, seems to be also observable on the 1.5 by 1.5 micron scale. So it's whatever is happening here, it seems it also happens on a sub-micron scale. And you can add more and more layer, and as you can see here, the structure changes a bit, but nothing too dramatic, and the span here, the strength of the signal grows with the number of layers. And actually, you can plot the RMS signal that you measure here, which means something a bit different, but it should still follow on the same scale the saturation magnetization. So you see that one follow each other pretty well. So all these images were done at zero field cooling. You see that there are very fine structure of the magnetism. So this is 1.5 or 1.5 micron, very fine feature. Our SQUID here was 100 nanometer diameter. So feature are about the same size as the SQUID. So now let's see what happens when we sweep the field, okay? So this is, some of you already saw this image actually, but this is the field that you measure for 8-unit cell LMO after you sweep the field to minus saturation field, and you go back to zero, and now I will raise the field here, and pick a point. Let's say this point right here. You see that there are little fluctuation events, and it happens throughout the sample. It seems there's like little magnetic noise. There are fluctuation, and as you reach the coercive field, these become more and more important. And then it calms down again, but you still have some flickering event throughout the sample. So another interesting feature about this image is that actually this is the last frame right here, right? This is the last frame, and this is the first frame. So you see that one actually has the color reverted with respect to each other. And that's actually greatly from a classical ferromagnet, where you would have a domain wall motion, and there's no reason why if you revert the magnetization, one should look as revert of the other. Okay, but let's look at these changes a bit more carefully, and this is one of the image for another sample of 12 unit cell at 160 millitesla. Okay, so this is what you get. This is the image. Now, if you take another image at 161 millitesla, it seems that there's almost no difference between these two images. It seems completely identical. Actually, if you subtract them, you see that there were actually four or five, let's say, or six distinct magnetization reversal of the in-plane magnetization. So it seems like there are four little magnets that flipped between these two images. And if you look at the scales here, this is 3.5 millitesla, whereas this is about an order of magnitude less. So there are very subtle change that happened between these two images. And how little they are, we can actually quantify that by doing a numerical fit of this image. So this is the numerical fit of these four events. And we can calculate the magnetic moment. So it's about 10 to the 4 for this guy and almost 10 to the 5 for this guy. And because we know, or we assuming, let's say, the moment that is carried per manganese, we can calculate the size of the particle that changed its magnetization, and it's about 10 nanometer. So there seems like little magnets flipping through the sample of 10 nanometer size. And this is between those two specific frames, but I can show you many of them as I sweep the field here. And you see that there are appearing these dipoles, call it, appear randomly through the sample. So this again is really a big difference compared to a standard ferromagnet, where you would see coherent flipping due to the domain wall, right? You would see the domain wall motion will generate events that are all correlated in space. Here, what you see is events that are completely uncorrelated in space. So how come these are uncorrelated? So we build a model where actually you have your STO and LMO layer. You have a charge transfer that we assume to be from the polar catastrophe, but it could be from other mechanism. Then we'll calculate the charge distribution and the electrostatic between these two capacitors, if you want. And finally, in principle, if you have charge transfer from the surface to the interface, you would assume that because of Coulomb repulsion, these charge will spread as much as possible. But actually, because this is an antiferromagnet, and adding a charge will turn it into a ferromagnet, which is conducting, you have a competition between the kinetic energy and the Coulomb energy, and actually you can minimize the Hamiltonian and get these sort of little puddles or droplets of ferromagnets embedded actually in an undope antiferromagnet. So what you see here that is transparent is just the antiferromagnet that is undope and insulating, and here what you have are little droplets, of magnetic particles or with ferromagnetic order. Another way to see it is that actually this is an antiferromagnet and these are super paramagnetic particles, most of them below their blocking temperature because we're at 4.2 Kelvin in this case. And we can calculate, so this is the histogram of sizes that we measured experimentally, and with this model we get about a 10 nanometer size, which is correspond more or less with the peak of our distribution. And using this model, if you look at this saturation magnetization, we can calculate what would be the magnetization, and it follows more or less the global measurement I showed you before. Now, just to finish, if this is a super paramagnet, does it have thermally activated flips? Even if we're at 4.2 Kelvin, are there some particles that flips with time? Is there some time dependence? So here what I'm showing you is the case of a 6-unit cell, and we sweep the time here from a few minutes to about an hour and a half, and you will see that there are, again, the same sort of dynamics. There are dipoles switching as time passes, and it seems that it carries on for quite a while. So this data is about a week or two old, so we haven't gone through all the statistics of these and see if we can get activation energies and so on. So to summarize, I've hoped to convince you that the squid on tip technique is now mature to study condensed matter systems. So I showed you two examples. One of them was vortices in superconductor. I showed you how we could, by using this AC technique, resolve the motion of the vortex down to 10 picometer. It showed some non-trivial response to the AC drive. But we explained this by a rather simple model where we have a few pins that were separated by either Xi, by distance a bit shorter than Xi or a bit larger than Xi. And the second story was on oxide heterostructure, where we studied this polar antiferromagnet that is grown on STO. And we found this very disordered magnet that looked from global measurement as a ferromagnet, but is indeed more as some super paramagnetic particles. And we have a model that represents this pretty well. So finally, I want to thank my colleagues, specifically Lior Rembon, who is the PhD student that just now graduated and is leaving us to do a postdoc. So he was the PhD student behind these projects. And these agency that founded me personally, and I'm grateful to them. And I will leave you with the rotating vortex. And thank you for your attention.
Do you have any plans to investigate the supernatural regime at
the what? Yes, that's definitely something that is, but okay, right now we have a helium-3 system and a helium-4 system, so we actually were limited technically, but that's just, you know, we can, in principle, that would be a very exciting system to study, yeah. Also, magnetism there is controversial, and it turns out we started with this, but actually that's also just to look, is it really an intrinsic effect, extrinsic effect, and so on. So yeah, that's all on the to-do list.
I have a question.
Yes.
What length scales are you sensitive to? So I know this technique works best if you have a localized magnetic moment under the tip to capture the flux.
Yeah.
So if you have a uniform field or if you have a uniform magnetization underneath,
then we're blind.
Then you're blind. So yes. Really, the images that we're seeing are a filtered image, right? So there's some length scale there that
that is true.
So what is that? What is that length scale? So is it just the tip size or
no, so if, okay, yeah, yes.
So if I'm just imagining if I have a magnetized region under your tip and I make it smaller and smaller, my sensitivity grows, right? And there's going to be some cut as well. It's not going to grow very much if you make it much, much smaller than the tip. But as I make it larger, Eventually, I'm going to be blind. So, yes. Where's that sort of crossover?
I think it's basically has to do with the distance to that structure and the size of the tip. I mean, so that will determine how. So if that structure is bigger than that, then you start losing signal, yeah. And the more extended you get it, the harder is it going to be to pick it up.
But then when you look at a reversal process, yes. Where you start seeing these dipoles,
yes.
So that picks out a particular component in the reversal.
That's true.
There could be other dynamics going on.
That's a good point. But actually, what's interesting is that if we compare, so I didn't show the data here, but actually, if you compare the magnetization curve from global magnetization and you scale it down to 1.5 micron, and then you add all these dipoles that we find, it's like almost one-to-one correspondence. So it seems like we're really capturing the difference is something like 10%, which is could be accounted easily just by sampling. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it depends from one pin and goes to the other. But what's interesting is that it doesn't get soft before there's no signs of softening. It abruptly snaps out of its previous well and goes to the other. So normally you would expect that before the inflection point in the potential you would get some softening or the restoring force will bend a bit. Here we almost don't see that. And you would think that, you know, just naively that you're at 4.2 Kelvin, thermal activation is not going to do anything. But it turns out that this configuration of several wells that are at critical distances between each other actually induces some ripples in the potential landscape, which makes the thermal activation irrelevant, it seems.
Even though your wells are
2 EV. Yeah, but you're actually tilting it. So once you're on the edge, the little ripple is what matters, it seems. Yeah, I mean you would not think, you know, 2 EV is several thousand Kelvin, 4 Kelvin is. Yeah.
So with regards to vortex phenomena, one of the things that people are very interested in, right, are quantum phase slips and quantum tunneling of vortices. And I wouldn't expect you to see tunneling of a macroscopic vortex. I would think the dissipation induced by the core motion would be too large. But you could imagine taking one to one wires where you have phase slips,
yes.
and not an actual core going through. And would this technique be useful for something like that?
Yes. That's also some other stuff.
I think there's no spatially resolved work that's been done.
Yes.
This is just a technical question. I mean, these are beautiful movies and everything.
Thank you.
But you have to scan between each step of current change or whatever. So how long do these frames take?
Yeah, that's a good question. So we tried also to look into this, if that influenced the dynamic. It doesn't seem that was a problem, but to just answer your question, each of these frames was about 3 minutes. Yeah. Or two to 3 minutes. I don't remember the number exactly, but it shouldn't be something different than that.
All right. If there are no further questions, let's thank the speaker one more time.